My name is Fraser.
My name is Mark.
And we are the hosts of the geekiest show alive. To the outside world, we're ordinary geeks.
But in the Fab International Studios, we talk comics and find other geeks just like us. This is Geek of the Week.
Welcome to Geek of the Week. This is issue 36 of your weekly comic book radio show here on Fab Radio. And I've had a bit of a problem. I was going to have a guest host, my friend Zach. I was going to have him on. And unfortunately, there was some technical issues with the studio. So I've had to record this at home and put it all together, kind of cobble it together myself on Audacity. So I can only apologise if it isn't of the sound quality that you would expect, but I wanted to get a show out there anyway. And with that, I think it's time for the news.
I need photos of Spider-Man.
With the sounds of J. Jonah Jameson, you know that it is time for the news. And I've got some interesting stuff this week. I'm going to go straight ahead and steam in with the Twitter web number four. If you've seen this on Twitter, Marvel Entertainment, they tweeted a spider's web with a number four, which got a huge load of speculation that they were going back to the original Spider-Man trilogy and doing a fourth one. And then they tweeted number three webbed as well. So that kind of put the scuppers on that. But we don't know what it is leading down to. At the time of recording, they got to number one. So at the time of recording, we're still waiting for what it is. But as far as I'm concerned, it's great marketing because it got people talking. So next week, I'll be able to go, well, it was a countdown to this. And I don't even know what I want, but it's going to be something Spider-Man related, and that's going to be good, right? And that will have Fraser dancing all the way over in America as well. Next up, the launch of Jessica Jones, which sees the final ever Netflix, Marvel Universe, Defenderverse, whatever you want to call it, show on that platform. And it's... what makes me sad is it's clearly been treated as a massive low priority by Netflix. I didn't see any promotion at all. And for the other shows, it was, you know, splashed over my Netflix as soon as I got in and stuff like that. They just wanted to get it out because they paid for it. And I don't think they care anymore. And that's very, very sad. Fess up time. I have not watched it yet because I'm still finishing Lucifer Series 4. And I'm loving that. Lucifer is magnificent. And they have launched Jessica Jones at the same time as an incredible number of shows that are right down my alley. Black Mirror and Designated Survivor as well have been launched. They're my kind of thing. So I'm going to try and get some Jessica Jones watch, but there's only a certain number of hours in the day. So I can't promise that I'm going to review that anytime soon. And the thing is, I might even savour it, as I know it's the last Defenderverse series that I'm ever going to see. I hope it's good. And if it is, I'm going to want to savour it. So, can't promise. I'm glad it's happened. And who knows what the future holds for Marvel TV shows. But it ain't on Netflix. And this really is an end of an era. One thing that is good about Marvel Studios, I've said enough about how much I'm sad that the Defenderverse is dead, but Marvel Studios have announced that they are going to San Diego Comic-Con, and they don't go every year. With Warner Brothers not turning up and doing their DC thing, it's Marvel being the big draw at San Diego Comic-Con, and just the possibilities of the kind of things that they could announce there, because it's always used as a platform to launch big things, announce big things. We could have castings for Nova, we could have a definitive list of the next phase of MCU films and what we can expect and when, which would be amazing. It could be X-Men, it could be Fantastic Four. The possibilities are endless, and it's a big deal that Marvel Studios are going to San Diego Comic-Con, because, well, the mind boggles. The mind boggles what they could announce. Moving on to our next topic, we have got Todd McFarlane returning to Spawn for the historic issue 301. He's going to write and draw and do a short run, from what I've read. And it's significant that it's 301 because it is a record breaker. It will be the most issues of an indie comic ever. I mean, obviously we know that there's 1,000 Detective Comics, but for a non-Marvel, non-DC comic, breaking over 300, it's never been done before, and Todd McFarlane is just sublime writing Spawn. So Spawn 301 is definitely going to be on pull or pass when it is launched. Headed back to some DC news, the full Pennyworth trailer was launched earlier this week. And from the start, it gave you a very clear statement of intent with a inappropriate for younger audiences announcement. Couldn't approve more of this. That's brilliant. So I'm looking forward to Pennyworth. The teaser got me in, and this is a good looking show. Nice and sinister. The kind of Batman take that I like, and I think it's really interesting that they're taking a risk on Alfred, because Alfred is brilliant. He is often one of the very best elements of Batman. Can he stand on his own? From what I've seen, I think he can. The Michael Caine accent is a bit odd. We British people don't tend to talk like that, but it didn't put me off. I just noticed that typical America. We all talk the same. We don't. I'm British and I don't sound anything like the Queen. So I don't know. That if that's the only thing that I can find that makes me go, then I'm looking forward to it. And I hope that it is a worldwide launch for Pennyworth. I do not pirate things, and I'm not a patient man. So I hate having to wait when I know that a show that I really have been looking forward to is available for our American friends, but there is no legal way for British people to be able to watch it. It's 2019. Everybody knows what has been released. It is utterly ridiculous. Big shows that people will be invested in and care about, are not done on a worldwide launch. It needs to get better, and I really hope that I get to see Pennyworth at the same time as our American brothers, geek brothers, we'll call them. And talking about more footage, we have got extra footage coming on the end of Endgame. They've added the Spider-Man trailer, which is great, but that wasn't extra footage. But they're actually adding a post-credit scene from the 28th of June. And as cynical as it is clearly a final attempt to knock off Avatar by making people who've seen the film go and see it again. And you know what? I want to see those post-credit scenes. I really want to see those post-credit scenes. So I'm probably going to go and see Endgame one more time. And the final piece of news, it's related to that. It is a potential casting in the MCU. And I'm quite excited about this. Keanu Reeves is in talks to play a character in the MCU. And it wasn't so long ago. Well, okay, it was 10 years ago. Where MCU didn't have the weight for superstars like Angelina Jolie and Keanu Reeves to be they wouldn't have even entertained it. And now it's great, and I can't wait for the next phase of Marvel. And Keanu Reeves, he was in The Matrix. He was Bill, or was he Ted? He was Ted. And he's been John Wick and so many other things. He's one of the most famous actors in the world. And that's just... it makes you want to fan cast who he's going to be. But I'm not going to, because the extra segments that I'm sticking in this week are two pre-recorded scenes, two pre-recorded segments that Fraser and I did before he left for America. I'm going to play you the first two of our four fan cast specials. Next up is the first of our two fan casts on this fan cast special, and it is time for Fraser and I, past Fraser and I, to talk about Batman.
It's back. We're doing some fan casts. Woohoo! There's going to be a couple of these over the summer.
There's going to be four. We've planned four.
Yeah.
And I don't. For me, woohoo is not my response to fan cast. I really struggle with this. I agonise over it, and all the hot guys that I like are too old for half of the characters that you give me.
That's a beautiful way of putting it. Well, we were talking about this because Fancast is very much we're sort of saying like looking at it generationally, because you like all the actors you would think of, like you said, would be too old. But also, like, I feel like
they're all about my age, and you can't have a 40-year-old Robin. That would make Batman 60.
Yeah,
so.
It would look a bit bizarre.
And considering Robert Pattinson is, like, what, 30?
Yeah.
You need, like, a teenager, exactly, like 16 as an absolute max. Down.
And I also feel as well it's like a millennial thing to fan cast in a way, or like a more recent thing to fan cast because of the internet. And
yeah, I struggle with this a lot. But I have also spoilt our first fan cast by talking about Batman and Robin.
Sneaked it in. But yeah, so with the news of Robert Pattinson, well, we're recording this at the time when he was announced to be Batman, but you know, some things can change. The Batman movie might not be happening anymore. It might be.
Who knows?
We don't know.
DC, isn't it?
DC.
We recorded this the week before Fraser left, so
who knows where this.
Yeah, we could have George Clooney back as Batman.
Exactly. Well, there's a theory that Batman v Superman isn't actually, the V in the middle isn't V, it's actually a symbol for five, and that's part of the universe before, you know, the George Clooney thingy.
Good grief.
That would just.
The DC universe is a mess, to the point where they've got a Joker film that's not
related,
and it's not got Batman in it. I mean, that's another conversation.
We're going, so this Batman fan cast that we're doing is for, yeah, it's for Robert Pattinson's and Matt Reeves, the Batman. We've also, I've got a few things to just throw in there, but I'll throw in there towards the end. Just
well, you gave me a list, which is what I went for. I can't do this. I'm really bad at it. And we've got four of these, and half of them have got the same actors on.
And some of yeah, have you repeated?
I have repeated quite a lot, but remember, some are DC, some are Marvel, so that's okay. It's just when I've done two Marvels, where it's the same guy.
You've made some actors very busy.
Some hot guys.
I think it's one of them as well. Like with this Batman one, it's an interesting one to start off with because we almost have to pick the fan cast, but also pick what they're doing in this film, because Matt Reeves, it seems to be like a prequel to the Batman, a younger Batman, but it's still the Ben Affleck Batman, I'm thinking.
So is it actually Batfleck? We don't actually know, do we?
No, I think we do. I think it's, they've said, but then again.
So is it going to be like set in the 90s or the late or the early 1000s, maybe then?
Yeah, yeah.
That would be cool. It worked really well for Captain Marvel, didn't it?
Yeah, so I think that's what we're going to bear in, we'll put that in mind, but we'll also, I'm going to throw a curveball into the thing, but that's towards the end. But let's start with.
I know you've probably cast the entire Batman universe.
I've got quite a few characters.
But I've got Joker, Riddler, Penguin, Two-Face, Catwoman, Batgirl, and Jim Gordon. Have you got much more than that?
I think I've got a couple more villains and stuff. But we'll start with your list, and then I'll.
Okay. Well, Joker.
Yes.
There's a question mark on Jared Leto.
Yeah.
Is he still going to be around? So it might just be him, you know?
It's also one of them. We've seen him go against Ben Affleck's Batman. And if Ben Affleck's Batman's going to be younger, is that Joker going to be younger as well? And
or it could just be that there were two Jokers. There's no reason why he can't kill the Joker that we cast.
Yeah.
And then Jared Leto's his son or something.
There is that Because there's the three Jokers theory in comics now, that there's like this free Batman found out there were three Jokers, so they could lean towards that. There was also when Jared Leto's character came out Joker, that they were like, oh, this is Jason Todd turning into Joker, and there's a big theory about that.
That's interesting. And that could, I mean, the thing is, we've seen so little of Leto's Joker that
it could be
they can actually play with that
anything or nothing at all.
Well, it's not going to be Joaquin Phoenix. It's not going to be him at all. That's a separate universe for sure. So, assuming that this is a first Joker and that Jared Leto is a son of Joker or an alternative Joker, yeah, I went for Tom Ellis.
Oh, nice.
Because he's gorgeous. Right? But bear with me, I know I go for hot guys, but because he's gorgeous, but have you seen the way he smirks in Lucifer? He's got like a nasty smile.
To him.
And I think
that's the big thing with the Joker, isn't it? It's that smile. Like when we did our trailer reaction, we both creeped out a bit.
We did the Joaquin Phoenix one. Smile. But I think Tom Ellis has shown us that he started off in Miranda, which was limited British sitcom where you just have to be cute and awkward. But he's played different stuff, and he's a hot actor right now. Not as in attractive, but hot, you know, like,
would you say both?
Yes, I would say both kinds of hot. And I think he's handsome enough that he could pull off the tortured, I'm so beautiful, oh my goodness, I've turned into the Joker.
Yeah.
Twisted. I think he could do that.
Especially if they dip into the origin of him falling into the thing. Mm. That sort of.
And I know you look at what people are predicting and on the internet. I've deliberately avoided that. So all of mine are sort of basically things out of my own mind without influence of anything else. Who did you pick for the Joker?
Well, interesting. I'm going to stop saying that because I keep saying interesting and I've just started tricking myself on it. You can have like a drinking game anytime I say it. But I've gone for someone who's already played a scary clown type character.
Go on.
Bill Skarsgård. He plays Pennywise in the recent It films.
Okay.
So clown for clown, that would make sense. And it's, you know, he's quite scary, is it?
He is quite scary.
Because I can't watch those films, they're far too scary.
Have you seen it?
No,
it's
I've seen the first one.
You've seen the first It film?
Like, a group of friends put it on.
Mate!
Like, at a house party. It was one of the scariest things of all.
If you want to go and see It, I'll stick it on. We'll watch It.
I'm alright. I'd rather see him as the Joker.
Okay,
that would be scary enough.
Let's watch It sometime. Great film.
But yeah, but I think he'd be a really good Joker. Like, that trip from Pennywise to Joker just seems like a natural fit, and I imagine it's a bit, it, like, I always sort of, sometimes I'll go for my, like, I'll go for my own thing, and if I'm really struggling, I'll go to the internet, but I always sort of go to the internet for reassurance, like, if someone else has suggested it, or, like, if there's an image of it, and then it sort of helps more. But with this, I think the image that really helped it was, oh, he's Pennywise, so it's a natural thing to sort of go from.
Yeah, fair enough.
From there. What character do you want to touch upon next?
Should we talk about Riddler?
Riddler, yeah, let's go for it.
Well, Riddler, in my head, Gotham got this quite right.
Yeah.
Deceptively attractive, nerdy guy that goes insane. So,
yeah, Gotham did it really well, the first season, that twist. And
I think, I don't even, I went for Orlando Bloom.
Oh, yeah.
Because he's beautiful, but I think he could play nerdy.
Yeah.
And I think he could play nerdy and then go manic.
And then go a bit.
And he's not so much
these days as well with the Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah, I haven't seen Orlando Bloom for a while, and he's pretty.
Yeah,
I want to see some Orlando. How about you?
I've gone for, one of my favourite performances, I think, in Batman is Jim Carrey as the Riddler, and I've always enjoyed Jim Carrey's work. Just naturally, I think he's incredible. But I've gone for sort of a similar sort of vibe to Jim Carrey, so like a comedian who can pull off the wacky voices and stuff like that,
okay,
but also can turn quite dark.
Yeah,
and I've gone for John Mulaney, the guy who voiced Spider-Ham, and you'll see.
Oh, okay.
He's done a lot of Saturday Night Live stuff, and he's more of a comedian.
I quite like that.
Than an actor, but I think he'd be quite good as the Riddler, like joking stuff like that. One of the picks I had for the longest time was Neil Patrick Harris. I think he would be really good as the Riddler.
Oh yeah, that's true.
But with this younger sort of he would have been good with opposed to Ben Affleck's Batman, where I feel like John Mulaney's a bit younger with it. So it's I only say that because some of my villains are quite that I've cast are older than Bruce, what Bruce Wayne would be. So I'm trying to keep it, you know, balanced. Some that are old, some
old,
and some that are some like what looking into Batman looking into his future, and some that are like, you know, you're in the same age, and John Mulaney seems like he's the same age as.
I think that's a nice little cast, isn't it?
Oh, I'm glad you liked.
You're doing well, and I'm not sure I am, but I'm pleased.
I'm liking,
I'm quite pleased with my penguin.
And it's all sort of like opinion based as well. Yeah. So, let's hear your penguin then.
My penguin is a little bit of a nod, but I also think he's a brilliant actor. Yeah. I've picked Michael Keaton. Which I think would be great, awesome. Kind of like bring it full circle. He's older now, play the penguin, and I think Michael Keaton I think he'd be brilliant, and I think with the right makeup and the right big nose, and I like the nod to the very first Batman.
Well, we'll go back to that because I've got that's my sort of off kilter thing I'm thinking. For Penguin, because Jack Black and Josh Gad both seemed really keen on being Penguin,
but you've talked about Josh Gad before.
And I've decided to go for Josh Gad for a different character for a kind of funny purpose. But I've sort of ignored either one of them, and I've gone for I'm probably going to butcher his name, but I'll tell him where he's from. So Alfred Molina,
the guy who played Doctor Octopus. Alfred Molina,
Alfred Molina from.
He was really good as Doctor Octopus.
Because I put Doc Ock, like I was like, yeah, him as Penguin would be sick, because there was, you know, some speculation a while back that he would play it for, and I've always had it in my head of him as Penguin, and that sort of it's one of them as well. He would have been perfect for the Ben Affleck aged Penguin, but then I couldn't think of a younger Penguin at the time. Like, the Penguin's been played really well on the Gotham TV
show. Yeah, he was very
so
good in that.
Finding someone like that, but then Alfred, and this guy's. I just had Doc Ock in my brain, then I was like, he can be the Penguin because, you know, it can. They don't all have to be the same age as Batman. Some can be older, and that can almost be like Batman looking into his future. Like, if I let money corrupt me too much, that's what I become.
Yeah.
Something like that. Because the rest of my Joker is quite young, and then, Riddler's quite young. My Two-Face is older, but.
I'm also quite pleased with my Two-Face, actually.
Go for your Two-Face.
So, James McAvoy. Him in not Switch, what's it called?
Split.
Having seen him in Split, and the fact that he can contort his face,
I
think he'd be really good for Two-Face because
I'd
prefer someone who can do that with their face rather than relying on CGI.
Actually having Two-Face.
I think that of all the modern actors, he's noticeably amazing at that sort of thing, and I think James McAvoy would be brilliant
because it'd be perfect as well because you're convincing me more. I think I might change my choice to yours.
I agonised over these. I spent hours. You sent me these lists of characters, and I went, oh, there's so many characters. I was all over the internet. I think like famous actors will probably think I'm stalking them all.
Yeah, you've had to search all these. It is those things with fan cast, isn't it? Because you have to search what they've been in and like where they work. We probably put too much thought into it.
Like a 20-minute segment.
It's fun to do.
So long. It was.
And then it goes into your brain though, and then you get all this creative thing going. But I do like that idea of like James McAvoy changing his face before he even comes to face, so you start to see it happen.
Yeah, and I think and then when he could give the part some real dignity and some real darkness. And
whenever someone asks me for my Two-Face now, it is going to be James McAvoy.
I
had so for the longest time I was thinking because Billy Dee Williams played Two-Face a while back in like the first Batman film, and I was thinking, maybe, you know, Donald Glover's done Lando so well, maybe you do Two-Face well, and I was like,
you do like your Donald Glover,
yeah, and it's falling into a slippery trap then of having, you know, because people were saying like Chris Pratt's the new Harrison Ford, so they were offering to give people were saying casting Chris Pratt as like Indiana Jones, and just saying, but they've got to be their own sort of actor in a way. So I've gone for someone else. And I've gone for someone who I was convinced was already Two-Faced. And I've gone for Guy Pearce.
Oh, I like Guy Pearce. He's hot.
Because I was thinking of that, you know, Memento, that sort of similar mind frame of your own, that ability to be able to switch from one to the other. And he was quite good as the, well, in Iron Man 3. I did enjoy him in that, and sort of, I can just see him doing that switch, but then as soon as you said James McAvoy, I'm like, oh, he does that switch incredibly well. But no, Guy Pearce would be, and he's another one, as well as Alfred, the guy who played, this is so weird saying Alfred, because I mean, the actor from a Penguin.
Alfred Molina.
Yeah. Them two, I sort of think...
Oh, I haven't cast an Alfred.
I think they would be my older ones. See, this is my thing. So with Alfred and a bit with Jim Gordon, I was thinking maybe just DH who they've already got, because they've got Jeremy Irons, dyes hair black. You won't be able to tell that he's...
So they've all, I guess they already have got them, and it's easily done now, de-aging people.
Yeah, with Jim Gordon as well, I found it really difficult. I don't think I've actually got a Jim Gordon.
Because who's the current Jim Gordon, or did we not?
J.K. Simmons.
So
we saw him briefly, and you can de-age J.K. Simmons. I don't think he's that, because he had a hat on, so maybe he just...
I'll be honest, I'd forgotten we'd already got a Gordon.
Yeah.
Because I did cast a Gordon, and...
No, I'd be interested to hear who you got, because my mind just went blank.
Well, I cast Jim Gordon and Batgirl together, because obviously she's his daughter. And I cast a father and daughter. Looking at, actors whose daughters are actors.
Yeah, yeah.
So I went for the simple reason he's fit. He's one of the sexiest men in the world. I went for Kiefer Sutherland for Jim Gordon, and therefore his daughter Sarah Sutherland for Batgirl.
Oh, nice. That's a good combination. Oh,
Kiefer Sutherland.
Yeah.
Oh, he's so beautiful. And that voice, man.
And the thing I was getting worked up with, though, with Jim Gordon was, I was like, he's got to look like Jim Gordon, but he's also got to look like J.K. Simmons, like, growing up.
I don't think he looks like J.K.
But yours makes sense, like, if they just...
I think I've just recast him completely. I'd forgotten that we already had a Jim Gordon.
Which could happen. My Batgirl, I've gone for someone who's quite local, actually. She's from Oldham. Olivia Cook. And this is someone who I've cast twice.
getting her work. We got a bit of a crush on her.
I just think she was really good in, because I got the whole redhead in my head when it came to thingy. I also thought Rosie Dawson would have been good, because she voiced Batgirl.
Rosario Dawson's very attractive woman. She's older than you think she is,
but
though.
Then that was the thing that sort of put me down, of the age thing, especially because she can't really be older than Batman, because Batgirl most of the time looks up to fingers.
She's kind of like almost implicitly between the ages of Batman and Robin.
Yeah.
So if Batman's 30, she needs to be 25, 22, 25.
Then, like, she can either, like, in the comics and other media, she's had a relationship with Robin, but she's also had a relationship with Batman, which was weird.
That's not weird. My partner's 10 years younger than me.
No, not that. It's just the way that she looked up to him, and it felt... You know how they talk about the Bat family?
Yeah.
It felt a bit... It didn't feel like the age difference was weird. It felt just a bit, not incestuous, but like, oh, come on. Like, you're a father figure. And then, for me, anyway. Olivia Cook,
people fall in love with their father figures.
She did
That's not unusual.
She did some great stuff recently with Ready Player One. She was the lead in that as well. So I think it would be cool to see her get more of work. And also, you know, local, Oldham. That's in Manchester. Like,
true.
It would be cool to see, and I think she'd do well in that, because...
The last one I've got was Catwoman, and I agonised over this one, because Catwoman has been mixed race, and then hasn't been mixed race, and then has been mixed race again, and then hasn't been mixed race, and I went for a white chick, I'm sorry. I went for a white chick because she's hot, and I actually genuinely think she'd make a very good Catwoman.
Yeah.
And she's red hot at the moment. She's been red hot since The Fifth Element. I've gone for Milla Jovovich.
Okay, nice.
I think she's got the build, and I just think she'd She'd look hot in a cat suit, basically. She's, and that's what you need for Catwoman. She's a good actor.
Yeah.
Who would look hot in a cat suit? Yeah. It was my choice was as simple as that.
Oh no, that's fair enough. For Catwoman, so there was a lot of I was for this I sort of almost did a joking thing because I was like, oh, we've got Robin Patterson as let's go for the full Twilight thing. Let's have Kristen Stewart as Catwoman. But then I saw it was funny because on Facebook, Kristen Stewart's fans have been petitioning for her to be Catwoman.
Oh, of course.
So
they
I
have.
Don't want that anymore, and instead. Still, she's still in Twilight, but I feel like there'd be better chemistry. Like, because apparently, Kristen Stewart and Robin Patterson, they did go out for a bit, but then she cheated on him in real life. So I don't need that kind of negative scene that, you know, it's the DC universe. We need it to be sort of fixing and stuff like that. But then an actress, I think, who I was joking at first, because, oh, she was also in Twilight. But then I was like, oh, no, wait, she'd actually be really good as Catwoman, is Anna Kendrick.
Okay.
She's been doing a lot of more, like, obviously she's known for, like, Pitch Perfect and sort of the comedic stuff.
Yeah.
But she's also been doing really dark stuff as well, and it would be cool to see her as Catwoman. She's reminds me almost as, I wasn't Sandra Bullock.
Sandra Bullock's a bit old to
not
play
Sandra
Catwoman.
Bullock. No, the one who played Catwoman in,
Eartha Kitt.
No, in the Nolan trilogy.
Eartha Kitt.
No.
Oh, Eartha Kitt.
No, not...
If she was still here, I'd want her to play Catwoman.
No, I'm always confusing her with... I'm constantly confusing her with Sandra Bullock, even though she's not Sandra Bullock.
I'm not going to be helpful. I've got nothing but Eartha Kitt going on in my head right now. I love Eartha Kitt. She was... I mean, and I know the classic Batman was campy, but Eartha Kitt was brilliant. Yeah. There's no one like
Anne
Eartha
Hathaway.
Kitt. Anne Hathaway.
Anne Hathaway, like, Anna Kendrick's got that sort of similar vibe to it, so yeah.
Yeah, she's pretty.
I could see his Catwoman. I could see her with Robert Pattinson as well, doing something quite good. Do you want to hear some of my jokey ones as well?
Yeah, go on.
So Josh Gad, I mentioned before, like, I don't really see him as
I think he's probably is going to end up as the Riddler.
Josh Gad? You mean Penguin?
Oh, sorry, yeah, Penguin. Yeah, yeah. Sorry, excuse me, Penguin.
I've got him as Mr. Freeze because he's the snowman Olaf in Frozen.
Right,
so
okay.
I think that'd be quite funny.
Right. That's probably not going to happen.
No, my Robin, I've got him as Jason Todd because we saw Jason Todd's suit in Batman v Superman, Joker being haha, jokes on you, and he, like, it's insinuated that he killed Robin. Now, this guy I had down as, like, as Damian Wayne, because Damian Wayne's, you know...
You don't like your Damian Wayne.
Don't like Damian Wayne, but it's that thing of, like, it's a child who thinks he's an adult, and we've seen that done perfect by number 5 from Umbrella Academy, so Adrian Gallagher, who plays number 5.
Okay.
I think he'd be a really good Damian Wayne, but Jason Todd would be the one that we'd probably see in this film, and I can also see him as Jason Todd, because Jason Todd's got that similar thing of he thinks he's an adult when he's not.
Yeah.
And it would be cool, just seeing him as Robin in some format. Now, this sort of leads on to my...
Did you have someone for Dick Grayson or not?
No, not really, because there's too many... You type in Dick Grayson Finecast, you don't want it. You're going to get absolutely
true
sort of thing. I would be interested to see sort of a more, like, a Asian actor take on Dick Grayson.
Okay.
Or, like, you know, someone who's more, like, into martial arts. But it'd be cool to get, like, a gymnast as well. Like, someone who's quite good with gymnastics. I mean,
yeah.
But, yeah, the guy they got for the TV series was quite good. But
yeah, he was.
I think... With this universe, I think we would have been past Dick Grayson. So the Robin we would have saw would be Jason Todd, but we might see Nightwing maybe on. And the thing is, as well,
that's interesting.
They could do a whole thing of. This is again leading to what I'm going, the curveball, but they could do that. Robin Patterson. This could be present day, and Robert Patterson is actually Dick Grayson becoming Batman.
Oh, okay.
Like they could go if they go for that twist. I wouldn't mind that as well.
Well, that's interesting.
Another one I've got, though, is that this is a Batman, instead of being, you know, a prequel, it's a Batman Beyond film, and you have Robert Pattinson doing the Batman Beyond character.
Okay.
And the Batman, and then get Michael Keaton back to be Bruce Wayne Batman.
Good grief.
That'd be pretty cool, wouldn't it?
That's an interesting idea. I don't think we'll be getting Michael Keaton back. I mean, the whole thing is this is fantasy. I don't think Michael Keaton will be interested in being the Penguin in reality.
I think Michael Keaton would be interested to go back into it. It's whether or not they would do it because, you know, he's delved back into, like, the Vulture and stuff like that, and he's gone into other stuff, so it could... There's potential there, I feel like, and... I don't know if there was someone talking about... Oh, no, so... There was this review for Detective Pikachu, and it was hilarious because they mentioned how Bill Nighy has managed to convince everyone that he's a serious British actor, but he just does all these character pieces.
Yeah, he does.
And it's like quite funny, and I think that almost Michael Keaton's done the same.
Yeah, yeah.
Sees him as a super serious actor, and it's like, wait, he was Beetlejuice, then he was he was Batman, he was. So he managed to sneak his way in, and even Birdman, which was a very iconic thing, it was like he's a bit bizarre in that as well. And it's almost a commentary on his own career in it. That
true
film. Did you have a Robin? Sorry, I might.
I didn't have a Robin, no, because you gave me a list of characters, and you gave me a list of four franchises and like six or eight characters for each one, and I was just like, oh, my brain hurts.
Yeah, no, there are some.
I don't know why I didn't cast a Robin. And I just can't do this off the cuff, so I got nothing, no, I'm afraid.
Fair. And it might be as well that this Bruce Wayne's quite young, so he might not have a Robin to start off with, and the Robin that they do cast in the future might not even be alive yet, or might not even be acting yet.
True.
Might be a wee baby.
True.
But,
yeah.
But that's our Batman fan cast anyway. But if we want to hear your fellow geeks in your fan cast, guys, girls, geeks of all kinds. So, who would you have in the Batman film? You can even, if you want to recast Batman again, feel free to do that. But let us know. You can pick the same characters we've done, or if you've got more, feel free. If you've got less, don't worry about it.
Just tell us what you think.
Any and all. Maybe even if you've got a different storyline, like you want to fully delve into Batman Beyond, or you want to do Dick Grayson as Batman, or you've got another Batman story that you think you could do.
Chat to us. Yeah. We'll chat back.
We've got a Facebook discussion group, and we've got a Twitter to keep the conversation rolling about this. Get the fanfare still. Bum, 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 bum.
Well, that was number one of our four summer fan casts.
Yeah, yeah. Don't worry, guys. Batman's sorted. We've planned it all.
Maybe. And now it is time for our second fan cast segment of the show, where Fraser and I will carry on casting who we want in roles in the future for future films featuring comic book characters, and it's Sinister Six this time. We've got six different Spider-Man baddies to cast. Take it away, past Fraser and past Mark.
Bum, 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 bum. It's another fan cast.
One of our four special fan casts.
Exactly.
And we've already done Batman, and I struggled with that.
So we've got four over the summer.
We have.
Another thing coming out over the summer is Spider-Man Far From Home. So we thought, why not fan cast the Sinister Six? With some already sort of appearing in the MCU, so I don't know about you. I've kept those ones who've already been cast as a thing, and I've gone... With this as well.
Yeah, well, I went for the classic Sinister Six, so I only actually had to fan cast four of them because I'm keeping Michael Keaton as the Vulture.
Yeah.
And we'll talk about Sandman in a bit. But yeah, I'm keeping Michael Keaton as the Vulture. And I know Scorpion wasn't one of the original Sinister Six, but we've got Michael Mando as him as well.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
So leave Vulture and Scorpion alone. I've got five to cast.
This was interesting when we went to when we were talking about doing this.
Four to cast. Jake Gyllenhaal's Mysterio, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. You were like, which Sinister Six are we doing? I was like, oh no, that'll be part of the choice as well. I was like, no, tell me to find six.
Yeah, because I was really stopping with you.
I always forget how much. Like, I was like, oh yeah, Mark's not really like Mark, and Tyke is like quite anxious with the fan cast because it can be a very
it
can be an ordeal.
And I'll be honest, over the four that we've done, I have used the same actor a couple of times.
So what I've done is I've sort of fan cast, obviously because it's Spider-Man, I absolutely adore it. I fan cast a load of different characters, and I'm thinking Because I think most of my Sinister Six that I would pick are already in the MCU.
We'll leave Mysterio as Jake Gyllenhaal, we'll leave Vulture as Michael Keaton, and we'll leave Scorpion as Michael Mando. That left me with four of the original Sinister Six to cast. Who else have you cast as well?
There's a couple I've cast. Let's go down the list. I've cast Doc Ock, I've cast Green Goblin, I've cast Electro, I've cast Kraven the Hunter. I've put a casting in for Mr. Negative, Sandman,
that's a bit obscure.
Rhino, Lizard, and done two sort of fan castings for Hobgoblin. But the thing with my sort of thing was, I was thinking of, because the Sinister Six, like the Avengers, have had so many different characters within it.
Yeah.
So I thought, right, I'll put a fan casting for him, and then through my fan casting, then I'll pick my six.
Okay.
Because what it might be like just a thing of actually see more of the ones we've already seen. Like, my Sinister Six probably would have Mysterio in, Vulture, who else are the Scorpion they've shown? So there's like, you know, there's three more left, but we've also seen the Tinkerer. We've seen Shocker in there as well.
Yeah, we have seen
and
Shocker.
We've seen Prowler, so technically we could have already seen a Sinister Six, but I doubt.
Yeah. I don't want them to rush the Sinister Six.
No.
I want to see the Sinister Six in maybe two or three films' time.
Yeah, it'd be cool to see them against this new Avengers, like they use the Sinister Six.
By the time we get to the Sinister Six, we could have Miles in the MCU as well.
Yeah, exactly. There's different ways in his, you know, he'll have a team of some sort anyway.
Should we do what we did the last time with Batman, and we'll go through the ones that we've both got, and then you can have a little bit of a chat.
Yeah,
so classic Sinister Six, Dr. Octopus. I loved Alfred Molina in that role.
Oh yeah, incredible. It was that sort of balance of you felt empathy for him, you felt sorry for him. It was that you saw when he turned, it was
and I thought
heart.
I thought Dr. Octopus is significantly older than Spider-Man is a dynamic that worked,
and it's one
so
of
I've kept with that with
it's
my choice
that thing of like the way they're doing it in the MCU now. I feel like a lot of these that I've cast are people he can see it as a new role model, because obviously Tony Stark was his role model, he passed away.
Yes, so that's interesting.
And I think a lot of his villains now are going to be role models he's looked up to a certain point, but then they turn on him, and that's going to be his damaging story all the way through, because Tony's sort of his Uncle Ben now.
Right,
like
yeah, of course.
Figure, and he's looking to almost replace Tony, because in the latest Far From Home, it looks like Mysterio could be the new mentor, and
that
doesn't work out for him. So I think a lot of my villains have gone with that, and I think it's like the Doc Ock storyline in the Spider-Man game was great, because it was that whole thing again of a mentor who turns, and you hate to see him turn. And he's sort of like, Doc Ock has been the leader of the Sinister Six as well, so it'd be interesting to see who we pick as our leaders as well.
Well, again, I'm going for classic, so Doc Ock is my leader. But I went for Anthony Head as my choice.
Ah, okay, nice, nice.
An attractive man who can play bookish and intelligent.
Yeah.
And I think he would give a real dignity to the role of Dr. Octopus, and he's got those acting chops that would give the part something strong,
a depth
for me,
rather than just it's the guy with the arms. It's you get behind the character behind the
and
arms.
You know, I'm a massive fan of Buffy and Anthony Head's hot,
so it would be a nice little throwback. So the Doc Ock I've gone for again for a sort of similar thing is I'd love to I think this guy's proved he's got the acting chops and the geeky chops, you know, he's a geek icon, to be honest, and he has shown that he can do the hero that's fallen down, or he can play the completely psychotic villain, and I've gone for Mark Hamill
as
Doc Ock. And I think that would be really cool, like seeing him as Peter's leader, and all of seeing like, it's Mark, it's lovable Mark Hamill, and seeing him turn into the psychotic almost.
You've gone for a similar vibe to me, an older guy
that Peter can look up to, and then when he falls down, because I thought it was great seeing Luke's change in the Last Jedi, where he's like, you know, he does go to that dark place, and seeing that him almost turn, and I think he plays that really well, and he's played that all the way throughout Star Wars. But he's and I say like I say, he's a geek icon. He's been in so many comic book based stuff, and he's going to be in more in the future.
Yeah,
and there has been talks about him. He's been talking with Marvel about stuff, and it would be really cool to see him in this. And
that would be really
nice
cool.
Nice little Spider-Man touch. I almost had him down as my Hobgoblin because he did voice the Hobgoblin.
Right.
I almost had him down as Green Goblin as well, because I thought he would, you know, him doing that Joker impression. But I feel like having that, seeing the nice side of Mark Hamill as well as the dark is important.
And he could definitely do that.
Yeah. So almost going for, I want to see both sides of Mark Hamill in Doc Ock. And
yeah.
Both sides of Doc Ock. So I think that would be, yeah.
Smooth.
Exciting.
Who have you got for Electro?
Electro, oh, you'll like this.
Because, the last time we saw Electro was Jamie Foxx, and
it was an
interesting take, but I didn't like it.
I liked the fanboy, like he was a Spider-Man fanboy, and it's sort of...
Yeah, but that's... It was too far away from the comics for me on Electro, yeah. but hey.
I've gone for Aaron Paul from Breaking Bad.
Okay,
fame.
Yeah.
I think he could play that, you know... just losing it, because he loses it quite a bit in Thingy. He loses it because he's taking, like, meth and stuff like that. But, you know, electricity could be the same. Counterbalance. And again, it's that thing of Aaron Paul's older than our Spider-Man Tom Holland, but he's not too old where you could repeat and use him quite a bit.
Yep.
Who did you go for?
Tom Ellis. And it's my first repeat.
Yeah, yeah.
And other than... I guess I looked at the... what Electro looks like in the comics, and you're not going to have the crazy electric face.
No.
But he's kind of like quite slim-faced and quite handsome,
yeah.
And I think that really was all I had, and I just fancy Tom Ellis, to be honest with you.
Yeah. It's nice. Some people do have that, though. They'll have their go-to actors for stuff, because, you know, it's... A lot of people always go for, you know, those two from Supernatural or whatever?
They're
almost in everything, and it's
neither
like,
of those would do as Electro. I have to admit, I wasn't inspired for a choice for Electro, really.
Yeah, they never... They always have them as, like, you know, if someone's like, oh, it could be Robin, it's always them two, or it could be Green. Like, they always go for the big cat, and I'm like, But I think, I'm happy with both our choices, definitely, with that. Because Electro is a tough one.
Electro is one I struggled with, I'll be honest.
Because when Jamie Foxx got cast, I was like, wow, that's a strong actor to play such a...
Yeah.
Not low-level Spider-Man character, but not as well-known as your other ones, and I would have thought Jamie Foxx would have gone for a bigger one, but it was kind of cool. Which is why it'd be cool to see. I think we've got the right level of actor to play Electro, like...
Yeah.
Not too big A-lister, but also, like, one people would know, so you sort of... People would care about the character.
Next up is Kraven the Hunter.
Oh, nice.
And I can't emphasise enough that I want to see a Kraven film before I see a rushed Kraven in a Sinister Six.
Well, they do...
I'm casting for Kraven the Hunter... Spider-Man, Kraven the Hunter, and then Sinister Six later on. I'm not interested
in a
10-minute intro at the start of a film where they mash all the six into one. I want a full Kraven film before we see him in the Sinister Six.
When you said that, I thought you meant like a Kraven solo film, because Sony are apparently working on that, and I kind of don't want to see that.
Oh, that's a shame, because it means we may not see him in the MCU.
That's my fear, so that's why when I put Kraven the Hunter, I was like, oh, he's definitely solid maybe. So why have we not cast Venom?
Right, of course. We can't cast Venom. We know we can't have Venom.
But I wouldn't mind maybe seeing, like, if they were to work out a deal, I wouldn't mind seeing Tom Hardy's Venom in the MCU. I just don't see it happening.
No, I don't see it happening. I think the deal is good, and we don't quite know who's going to have whom and stuff like that. Exactly. So the classic Sinister Six we won't see in the Venom, because we've already got Mysterio and Vulture in the MCU.
I think as well, Kraven the Hunter does lead himself to a more darker rating, so it seeming that's why that Venomverse sort of makes sense.
But I think there's so many good Spider-Man villains that it doesn't matter that we're only getting halfy-halfy.
Exactly, because you
there's still plenty of great stuff. We're not going to see Morbius in the MCU, but we've already seen Mysterio.
Exactly.
That's great.
That's really cool. And, like, that's what I have enjoyed about it. Now, with Kraven the Hunter, there's two different versions. So I sort of tried to balance it between the two. Because in the Ultimate Comics, he's Australian, and he's a reality star in a way. He's sort of like...
That's not the one I've got
He's
for.
Kraven the Hunter, but he like... So he'll hunt all these different animals and have a reality show.
Awful.
And it sounds awful. No, it's quite good, because he tries the whole thing of him trying to hunt the spider. You know, he's trying to hunt Spider-Man, and he loses his show because of it, and that's when he turns into the Kraven, you know, from the comics. And that's when he sort of loses it. And I think it's a better modern way of doing it. It's almost sort of like a twist on the Steve Irwin kind of thing.
Yeah.
But I do like original...
I've not Kraven. Read any of that, so I've been... My choice is inspired by the classic
I do like the Kraven. I like the original Kraven as well, who's like, I think Russian or, you know, Eastern European, and it's sort of that... that thing. The only worry with that is that if you get an American to do the accent, it might seem a bit either like what's the word to say, like
contrived?
No, that like offensive to people from that country.
Yeah.
Or it might become a Elizabeth Olsen Wanda situation where the accent gets lost.
Yes.
After a couple of movies, but if they're not in that much movies, it's okay. So sort of gone for a character that could do both. Mm-hmm. But who's your pick first?
Well, Kraven is older than Spider-Man, so I thought this was going to be an easy choice for me, but then I went too old. My initial thought was Ian McShane.
Oh, yeah.
Because he's got the look, he's got the acting chops that I think he could be a great Kraven, but he's 76.
Yeah, that is a bit too... And he's got to be, like, brawling, being able to...
And I don't... Unless there's some kind of CGI magic, I just don't... I think Ian McShane...
Could you imagine, like,
David, 20 years ago would have been a perfect Kraven.
Yeah.
So I thought about it, and I do keep going back to the same actors. I think Kiefer Sutherland, the voice would be great
for Kraven,
and put a kind of like a Diablo tash on him. He would have the right look.
Yeah.
And Kiefer Sutherland. I'm actually quite pleased with that choice.
I've gone for another throwback, really. I've gone for Joe Manganiello.
Okay.
And he played... Because this is really funny, because he played Flash Thompson in the original load of Spider-Man things.
Right.
But Jake Gyllenhaal was supposed to be nearly replaced Tobey Maguire in the second film when he demanded more money.
Oh, okay.
So we nearly had Jake Gyllenhaal as Spider-Man, and I think that Joe Manganiello, that would be a fun little, you know, callback. I was going to say Jason Momoa because of, like, Tom Holland on a press conference has talked about how great he would be as, and he would be exceptional as Kraven the Hunter. Like, seeing images from him from Game of Thrones, I could totally see that sort of barbaric, but still
being
able to...
He's too hot. In all seriousness, I think he's too... Shiny?
I think they could... No, they can easily change that, like, a bit of, like, you know, bit of makeup, bit of CGI.
Maybe. Maybe.
I think he would have been perfect, but then Aquaman's been quite successful, so I think he's going to be busy with that.
And, you know, a Spider-Man baddie compared to a DC A-lister character. Which it's whether or not he wants the part, isn't it?
The thing is, as well, with Jer... I'm just going to say Joe instead of butchering his last name again.
Jason Momoa?
No, Joe Manganiello.
Oh, Joe Manganiello, right, sorry.
Yeah, I think the thing is with him, yes, he's Deathstroke, but that, again, like you say, it's a villain, it's another villain rather than... And people have played two villains before, like, you know, Josh Brolin did, well, it wasn't a villain, did Cable and did Thanos, and that was a, you know, that's an easy manageable thing because you won't be required as often. So I think that's why I've gone for Kraven the Hunter, and that thing of he could do either one. He could do the Reality Star one, or he could do Reality Star one turned into Crazed Man, or he can do the Crazed Man from the start. He can do either or both. So I think that's why I went for, I'm for him. Who have you got up next?
My last one that I actually fan-casted was Sandman, but I've put a question mark by that anyway, because we've got Magnum coming up in Far From Home.
Yeah.
Who, it isn't Sandman, but it is very similar to Sandman.
Yeah, because they've gone for the Elemental.
So it's not Sandman, because when I first saw the Far From Home trailer, I thought Sandman was in it. But it's not Sandman, it's Magnum.
They were thinking about just turning Magnum into Sandman or doing like an amalgam sort of thing, weren't they?
Yeah, well? So if that's the case, we've already got Thomas Hayden Church.
And they were going to have like Hydro Man as well as maybe as Sandman as well, yeah.
Yeah, but again, it's not Hydro Man in the film. And in the comic books, Sandman is very, very chinny. He's got a big chin.
Oh, I know who you're going for.
You know what I'm going for?
Yeah, yeah.
He's got a big chin. He's very butch and strong. He's very kind of macho, gym-goer kind of guy. So, big chin, big muscles. Who better than Ron Perlman?
Of course.
He is the chinniest actor there is.
Chins for days.
Chinzilla.
Chin-chinnery. Chin-chin.
I was looking at images of Sandman in the comics, and I was like, who looks like Ron Perlman? Looks like that. Ron Perlman with his chin.
It's one of them as well. Sandman's become a hero, like, in the comics. He's like, he's been a member of the Avengers.
He has.
So it's one of them.
I read it at the time when he joined the Avengers. I was like, but it's Sandman, he's a baddie.
I've gone, so for my Sandman, I've gone for a pairing with Rhino as well, because I saw a couple of people mention this. For Sandman, I've gone for Wentworth Miller, who played Captain Cold in The Flash.
Wentworth Miller's so beautiful.
And for Rhino, I've gone for Dominic Purcell. You know the guy.
Dominic Purcell?
Yeah, yeah, who plays. So them two.
He's a different kind of hot.
Them two as a pair on a team, because a lot of people had Dominic for their Sandman.
Yeah,
I think. Also, people had Dominic for Rhino as well. So I was like, right, have Dominic as Rhino and have Wentworth Miller as them. Because I'd love to see them two together in a team.
Yeah, Wentworth Miller's too pretty for Sandman. Sandman needs to be chinny.
No, but the thing is, Sandman can be, you know, it's that thing of, I'd like the dynamic between them. But I also like that, like we said with Doc Ock, that human side of Sandman, like when he's away, when he's not sand, he's, you know, being able to reflect and stuff. Will has done some beautiful stuff.
He's a great actor.
He's done some beautiful stuff on Legends of Tomorrow as well, like the dramatic side as well as being that Captain Cold.
I mean, I know him from Prison Break.
Yeah, yeah, because that's where them two went there, and then they went. So it'd be nice that bringing them together. Mm. So I couldn't cast one without casting the other. So I brought Wentworth Miller along, and I was like, yeah, you can be my friend, man.
So beautiful.
And I thought that would make you happy as well.
He's a pretty, pretty man. He's not chinny enough for Sandman, though.
No. So, other people have come forward. So, with the recent video game coming out, Mr. Negative was part of the Sinister Six. And I think it would be cool to see Mr. Negative in cinema. Mm. But maybe not. I always thought it would have been great to see him in an Iron Fist film, or like maybe a Doctor Strange thing.
Okay.
You know,
well, you ain't going to see Iron Fist, are you?
He's also a... well, that's the thing. If we maybe reintroduce Iron Fist in Doctor Strange and then do something there, and, you know, there's ways around it. But I think if Mr. Negative ever popped up in a way, and it'd be really cool to see, because the visionary stuff they did in the film was exceptional. Like, it was all beautiful. And that whole thing of, like, going into his backstory and tapping into this heritage and this crazy world. I did have Randall Park, but he was in Ant-Man and the Wasp, and he was quite a comedic character in that, so I can't really see that.
Okay,
I'm just going to go out and say it. Ken Watanabe for Mr. Negative, I mean. It's just...
Your community, though.
It's just got to be, and do you know what I mean? So I was like, yeah, Ken Watanabe for Mr. Negative, that's the one, if you're going to have him. Lizard, I've cast the Lizard as well. This guy I picked mainly because he looks exactly like the Lizard we had in Amazing Spider-Man.
Okay.
But I've gone for Stephen Merchant, you know, from...
Stephen Merchant!
For the Lizard. I think he would be a quite good, really good Kurt Connors, and then turn into a thing.
He was great in Logan.
Yeah.
He was a revelation.
So I thought that would be good. Now, I think I'm going to have a Goblin in my Sinister Six.
Okay.
And I'm debating between Green Goblin and Hobgoblin, because what I was thinking was, if you have Green Goblin, you sort of have to introduce Harry Osborn.
Mm.
But Harry Osborn is the best friend of Peter Parker, but he'd get overshadowed by another best friend, which is Ned Leeds. And Ned Leeds in the comics turns into Hobgoblin. But I thought it'd be interesting to maybe have him as Ned Leeds Jr., and have a Ned Leeds Senior who does become the Hobgoblin, and then they can do Harry Osborn, like, Goblin stories with Ned and
Peter that way.
And I've chosen Jason Scott Lee, who played Bruce Lee and is going to be in Mulan 2020, so he's got some deals with Disney.
Yeah, yeah.
And with this, it was very hard to find a Ned Leeds dad, so I looked for, because the actor who plays him, Jacob Bateman, he's Hawaiian descent, so I looked for Hawaiian actors, and that's why I went for Jason Scott Lee.
Okay.
But if they do want to introduce the Osbournes, I've gone for someone who I think would play a really good dad who's just, you know, disappointed with his son, and would also be sort of someone Aunt May wouldn't really get on with, and it's like, I don't really want you to hang with. And he's someone who's already played a dad before.
Go
and
on.
It's Jason Isaac, who played Malfoy's dad. Draco Malfoy's dad.
He was great as Lucius Malfoy.
And he was also exceptional.
He was mean.
He was exceptional in Peter Pan as well, because he played, you know, Captain Hook and the dad then. So I think that'd be, he'd be a really cool goblin to be like, he'd master Norman Osborn as well as the Green Goblin.
That's a nice choice.
That transition.
That's a nice choice.
Yeah. So should we, I reckon, because I've thrown so many characters out there, should we form our own Sinister Six with the pair of us? Because I've got so many characters. So
The ones I'm quite passionate about, right, we'll keep the Vulture, which is Michael Keaton.
Yeah.
And we'll keep Mysterio, which is Jake Gyllenhaal. We need to add four more. So maybe if we take it in turns to add our two favourite choices.
Yeah, I think if we put Scorpion in as well, because he's been introduced.
Oh, okay, so we'll keep Scorpion. So do you want two and I have one? There's only
Let's have one each.
One each.
Sort of like have a vote for. So what are the two you're passionate about?
I'm quite passionate about my choice for Sandman and my choice for Kraven. Kiefer Sutherland for Kraven and Ron Perlman for Sandman.
So let's put Kraven in the team.
Okay, so Kiefer Sutherland is playing Kraven.
Just like as our team. So my choices for my Sinister Six will still be with this team, just the characters we're choosing.
Oh, okay, sorry, right. I still want to put Kraven in because I want to see Kraven in a film.
For sure. I want to see.
But again, with the caveat that we get a Kraven film before we get the Sinister Six.
Yeah, let's put.
I think. Should we agree that our mutual choice is Doc Ock? Because we both thought that he was the leader.
Yeah, Doc Ock.
So you've got your pick for the final member.
Leader, I'd say Electro. And let's say that this is the first draft of the team, and that I reckon they go against like a Norman Osborn, or they go against someone, and that's why Peter has to go against him. You know, similar how they did in the video game.
Yeah.
And then maybe have Norman work with him future, or maybe even have someone like a Wilson Fisk.
Yeah.
So these six are the core members, but then these other villains work with him. And like,
I'll be very cross if Wilson Fisk isn't the guy that played him in Daredevil,
Vincent
though.
Vincent D'Onofrio, yeah, it's got to be him. And he's like a movie star as well. He's been in like Jurassic World, so I can see him in it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that's our core Sinister Six. And I'll be honest, that's a pretty sick Sinister Six.
Yeah, we got this.
If we got to see that in film, I would definitely lose it. But yeah, that's exceptional.
But tell us what you think. Who would you want in your Sinister Six? Do you want the classic? Do you want to mix it up?
What
do you want to get rid of Mysterio and Vulture, even though they're established characters? What is your Sinister Six, and who would you play them?
Exactly. Let us know in our Facebook discussion group. We'll get a thread going, but we want you to, you know, throw it all in there.
Just talk to us. We like to chat.
We've also got Twitter as well, so Facebook group and Twitter, you know, just search for us there. And yeah, let's keep this conversation rolling and get geeky. But yeah, I'm really happy about this because it just gets me talking more about Spidey. And if this is out around the time, it will be summertime anyway. Go watch Far From Home as well.
Yeah, talk to us about Far From Home.
Yeah.
But that was Fancast.
I am from Far From Home right
you
now.
You are Far From Home right now. But yeah, that was Fancast for the Sinister Six.
Hi. This is Mark, one of your co-hosts for Geek of the Week on Fab Radio. When I'm not reading comics, or talking about comics on the radio, I'm a humanist wedding celebrant. Humanists are people who don't have any religious faith and live life ethically, logically, and to the absolute full, because we believe that this is the only life we have. A celebrant is someone who can perform a non-religious wedding ceremony. I am accredited by Humanism UK and specialise in writing and presenting bespoke wedding ceremonies to suit any couple. If you want a completely unique wedding tailored to you and your partner that will make your special day even more perfect, then a humanist ceremony conducted by me is what you're looking for. I can cater for any ceremony that you might want, from a traditional style to a wedding on a clifftop, to a wedding as far out and geeky as you can possibly imagine. For more information, visit my website, humanist.org.uk/Mark Adams, or email me on mark.adams@humanistceremonies.org.uk. Quote Geek of the Week FAB for a 10% discount on my usual fee. Music by Audionautics.com.
And now, it's time for this. That's right, it's time for pull or pass. And I've got three choices this week. They are Psi-Lords, Warlord of Mars Attacks, and Usagi Yojimbo Bunraku. And at this point, I just want to point out that Pull or Pass is sponsored by Travelling Man. They've got places in Manchester, in York, in Leeds, and in Newcastle. And until the end of June, they have 2-for-1 on C7 manga and first, second graphic novels. Remember, Travelling Man have sponsored us since Free Comic Book Month. They always do us a solid, and they are brilliant. They are a comic book shop that cares. I've got my pull at Travelling Man in Manchester, and check them out if you live in any of those cities. Pull or Pass is the part of the show where we look at three comic books that have been released this week. Always on a Wednesday. New Comic Book Day is a Wednesday, so earlier this week I picked those three books, and I look at them and I decide whether or not I would like to add them to my pull. What is your pull, I hear you ask? And if this is your first time listening, then I'm going to explain that to you. If it's like your potentially 36th time listening, you know, but I'll be quick. Your pull is essentially a casual subscription service at your local comic book store. You don't need to give them a direct debit. You don't need to commit as much as perhaps if you were subscribing for a delivery service. And you give them a list of the comic books that you like, that you want them to keep each book back for them. And when you bob in, you say, what have you got in my pull? And they show you what you've got. You can go in once a month and get a big pile of comics, or you can go in every week and your pull is always ready behind the counter, and it means that you don't miss an issue of your favourite comic book. First up this week, I looked at the Warlord of Mars Attacks. And, yeah, there's a guy in it called John Carter. He is the Warlord of Mars, apparently. Yeah, I'd never heard of him. And, he was fine. Perhaps a little shallow. Perhaps a little bit, maybe a bit tropey. But as a first introduction to him, there wasn't enough for me to really give a good judgment. There was quite a lot of fun with the translation of the Mars Attacks. The dab, dab, dab that they did in the film. But what bothered me is they didn't all just go dab, dab, dab. They had different kind of language to the film, and that annoyed me more than perhaps it should have done. But the translation of it was very funny, because it was phrased in the way the translation machine in the film would have done. We are your friends, that kind of thing. It really did seem to capture the vibe of the Mars Attacks film. I thought it was encapsulated very well with some of the more ridiculous stuff, like a guy called Ramon just ending up in NASA because he blagged a ticket, and the plot was very kind of Mars Attacks, and I liked how it got the Mars Attacks vibe. But the thing is, I liked Mars Attacks, but I've no idea who the Warlord of Mars is. And I think I'd like to read more Mars Attacks comics, because I felt they got, they got the vibe right, but not this one, because it's a crossover, and it's a crossover with someone I'm not that into. So that one is unfortunately a pass. Next up, I looked at Psi-Lords, and this was my kind of thing. Weird, quite dark sci-fi, and the artwork was something very, very special. There was a particular double page spread where a fight scene with four different colours to represent the four different heroes, and it was so, so beautiful. And yeah, it was, yeah, it's looking like it's something special. But for me, what really I couldn't forgive was it was advertised as Psi-Lords, and just after the centre pages, it finished, and then it was something else completely different, which I didn't even bother to read, and lots of adverts. I don't want half a comic. I don't want half of what I'm promised without even something saying that that there's going to be another story of another franchise in there. I didn't like it. It annoyed me. And I liked what I saw of Psi-Lords, but I didn't see very much of Psi-Lords. And if they're going to cut it in half every single week, I'll be paying for essentially half of what I want to read. So it's kind of a bit of a tantrum pass on that one. So I don't care. I can say what I like. And yeah, massive tantrum. It really... The new comic book day, free comic book day stuff where they did like halved comics, I didn't like it. And I've never liked it. If I buy a title, I buy it for a specific title. And yeah, not for me when you cut your comic book in half. Which is a shame because I did think that Psi-Lords had got something that I'd have been interested in otherwise. And third and finally, I looked at Usagi, Yojimbo, Bunraku. And I didn't like the art. I'm being such a negative Nancy and it's really bothering me. I picked three books that I thought I might like. And maybe I'm in a funny mood, but the art, it felt like a kid's comic, like the Beano or the Phoenix or something like that. And it was not that it wasn't good kid's art. But I don't know, because it's Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle franchise, I was expecting something a bit more gory, a bit more graphic. One thing it did get right, though, was a depiction of a stylized samurai sword attack. That it felt very cinematic, and it captured that very well. So that's kind of like... It's not all bad, and like I say, it was very good children's art, and that really surprised me, the cinematic sword attack that they managed to incorporate in. That was cool. The storyline wasn't what I expected, but it was actually well written, and I didn't hate it, but I genuinely have no desire to read any more. And that's a bit of a shame, really, because it's three passes, and I don't think I've ever had three passes. I guess that sometimes happens. Well, I've just said I haven't had it before, and then I said that sometimes happens. Monologuing is hard. I miss you, Fraser. So yeah, that was pull off pass for this week. It was a bit of a glum one, I'm afraid. I didn't like anything. And that is all we've got time for on this very kind of cobbled together version of Geek of the Week. I've done the best I can, and I just wanted to get an episode out there. I hope you've enjoyed it anyway. I've had a fab time in a way, sat in my onesie in my living room. I hope you have too, and I'll see you next week on Geek of the Week.
Great Scott! It's been almost an hour. What the devil are they doing?
Rest assured that I was on the internet within minutes, registering my disgust throughout the world.
Thanks for listening to Geek of the Week. Be sure to tune in next week. Same geek time, same geek channel.
And if you want to follow us on social media, it's at GOTW Radio on Twitter. Search for Geek of the Week Radio Show on Facebook. And to listen again, it's www.mixcloud.com/Geek of the Week Radio Show.